All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another edition of the Global Reality. Right here on the Global Reality Radio Network, I'm your host, Josh Reeves. This is the Monday, March 27th, 2017 edition of the broadcast, and we thank you so much for being here with us for another edition of the show. I have been busy getting working all the various film projects and getting everything ready to go. I'm hoping to have the newest 1.5 edition of the Spellcasters. You know, so much has occurred and so much other stuff has happened, and Volume 2 is going to be such a different film than Volume 1 that it really would have made Volume 2, number one, way too long, and also less about what I wanted Volume 2 to be about. So I've got a separate 1.5 version that's going to be coming out very soon. I'm working on getting that out sometime this week, hopefully. And that's what I've been doing. That's what I've been working on. We also launched our newest, the newest show I mentioned on the last broadcast, Josh Watches. It's now available on YouTube. Episode 1 is Josh Watches Confessions of a Dangerous Mind. Of course, Chuck Barris, subject of the book and the film, died last week. So the day he died, I said, "Oh, there we go. There's our." I was just about to record, about a day or so away from recording the first episode, but I decided I have a lot of films I'm going to do, tons. But I didn't know which one I particularly wanted to do first. I decided to just let it come to me, and boy, did it ever. And so thanks to everybody who checked that out and listened to that. We'll try to provide, at least for the first 30 days, the videos up, we'll try to provide links. But also check the comment sections. I noticed somebody else posted some links in there, so always check the comments on YouTube. You might see other links and stuff that people have posted, you know, for links to the actual movie and stuff. But there's some of the ones, I think probably maybe the next one we're going to be doing is a bit more obscure of a film, so I don't know how readily available or not readily available copies of this film are, but I don't particularly think it's that readily available. But anyway, it's a lot of fun, and I can't wait to do a whole bunch more, and I can't wait to get some suggestions out there from you guys on ones you'd like to see as well. But I've got a lot, and I think you guys are going to probably enjoy all the ones I'm going to pick out, because I have a feeling a lot of the ones I'm going to be doing are a lot of your favorite movies as well, at least some of you anyway, because we've talked about some of these movies I'm going to be doing, you know, we've talked about here on the show before. So there's that. What else? What else was I going to mention here at the top of the show? Can't really remember. It'll come to me. I don't think there was anything else particularly I wanted to mention. We've got some emails and listener comments I want to get to at the top of the show today for you. And then hopefully we'll have some time to get into some news, because I've got stacks and stacks and stacks upon stacks of news that's been sitting here piling up for weeks. So we'll do our best to get into that. If not, we've got plenty of material for this week, that is for sure. So, and I will be doing, I'm going to be doing the Josh Watches program. I'm going to be trying to do one of those at least once a week. So please spread the word about that. Not every episode particularly is going to be about information. I've already seen some people leaving comments. Oh, I can't wait to tune into these for the info every week. I'm like, well, you know, maybe, maybe not. Don't get your hopes up. I've already said this as a disclaimer from the very beginning. Not every one of these that we do is going to be information packed. You know what I'm saying? I mean, the first one we did obviously was good fodder for that because of the subject material. So, but you know, not every, I want to warn you ahead of time. I don't want people thinking that, because I want people who who might not be into the regular stuff that we talk about here on this show to be able to watch those and appreciate them for what they are. Because really, it's just really about, you know, having fun, and also me being able to infer information that I have that I wouldn't have. You know, there's stuff that if you listen even to the first episode, this is how they're all going to be. But if you listen even to that first episode with that movie, I mean, there's stuff in there that I talk about that, you know, in the general course of doing a radio show, oftentimes a lot of those topics and subjects aren't going to really come up, you know. So I think that's the interesting thing about this concept that I came up with doing it this way. And it's because it gives me an opportunity, especially with movies that I've seen a lot, you know. That really is a big thing. If I've seen something a lot, it's one of my favorites, and I know every moment, and I have a lot of information on it because I'm passionate about the film, then it's going to have a lot of information. And I love that. I think it's really going to spawn, you know, conversation. It's going to give people knowledge and information and insight. Because, you know, I've listened to some of these director commentaries sometimes, but it just seems to me like they're never... Oh, some of the commentaries, if you listen to for some DVDs and whatnot, they just never... You can tell they're not wanting to do it. They don't want to be there. It's, you know, they're probably not getting paid. It's just an additional thing and time out of their day they got to do and sit there and be in front of a microphone and talk about this thing they made. And, you know, they're really into it. But this is a different type of thing because there's just so much encoded in this. The next film we're going to be doing this week, I think you guys, if you're not already aware of this film, once you see what it is, it's going to be a surprise till the video comes out. I won't tell you what we're going to do. You won't know what it's going to be week to week. You won't even know what film it is until the episode's posted, because I won't be revealing it until then. But the one that we're going to be doing this week is pretty fucking obscure. But I'm sure there's probably some of you out there that already were aware of this film and are aware of it and whatnot, but... guarantee there's going to be a lot that aren't, and I think a lot of the little things in it, it's a very, a lot of things in it that are very pertinent today, and a lot of stuff that this film, it just shows to show you how long they've been doing the predictive programming stuff. It's been going on for quite some time. You know, that last show that we did where we discussed because I had lots of questions, you know, people have been asking tons and tons of questions about the whole Freeman thing. Ever since I started talking about free zoners, I was talking about the free zone Scientology. It was something I wasn't aware of for quite some time, but once I became aware of it and learned about it, it filled in the gaps on all the stuff with people like Jim Mars and Louis Farrakhan and these people who, in, you know, Alex Jones, who appear to have these connections, but yet they're not actual Scientologists. And we'll talk more about that particular subject later, because I've got an email I want to address on the subject as well. But we were talking about that. So that, you know, I mentioned this back in October. I talked about the Free Zone Scientology thing, and even mentioned that, you know, thought it was kind of strange that Freeman's show was called that, kind of a strange coincidence, especially when you're somebody like me who does not believe in coincidences anymore, for good reason. But, and it didn't really register on anybody's radar. And then I mentioned it this last time, and everybody went nuts about it and started saying, you know, talking about Freeman and whatnot. But, you know, again, no matter what I say on it, it's going to come back and say, and people are going to come back and say that I was making this accusation, and I'm not sitting here saying making the accusation about it. Sure, I'll say I think it's weird, and I think it's, you know, nothing is a coincidence, but I'm really going to leave that up to everybody out there to decide. I'm not going to come to you, but I wanted to read some of the comments on this, and a lot of people asked me about another person. It's crazy. After that show, I got a comment and an email, not kidding you, 2 minutes apart from each other, from two separate people asking a question about the same person, Mark Passio. I've gotten lots of questions about him. I'll be honest with you, I've never talked about that guy, and people ask about him, I've never addressed him or anything, because I've never listened to his stuff, because the one time I did hear some of his stuff, it was total garbage disinfo. I mean, like, straight the fuck up. And a lot of other stuff that people have pointed out to me about the guy I've seen. So there's never really any point for me to comment on him or talk about him or anything else. I mean, that's, again, you have to learn to come to your own conclusions on these things. I can't be, I'm trying to fight this stuff, and I'm trying to expose what needs to be exposed, but I'm not Mr. It drives me crazy. I'm not Mr. Vetter of every single person. You know what I'm saying? I don't want that fucking position. I didn't apply for it, and I don't accept it. So I'm not going to sit here and play the, you know, is every single person in this game. I'm not going to do it. I mean, I focus on certain people, certain, you know, elements of this, but I'm not going to be the guy that's going after every single individual person. That's not what this is about. So that my point is, you have to take the research and the information and the whatnot that I've provided and presented all these years, over, you know, almost 10 years now on air, and come to your own conclusions for a lot of these people. You know, if I can't be bothered to comment or you know, do films and on every, I mean, people are always, what about this person? What about this person over here? And I go, yeah, he's connected to that. I mean, clearly where there's smoke, there's fire, you know. But that's not enough for them. And I'm like, well, I can't take on every single part. I mean, this is what I'm trying to tell you. Hopefully this should wake you up as to how widespread this stuff is. But, yeah, Passio, somebody pointed out too, and I heard this, that he was promoting Battlefield Earth just like Jim Mars. He talked about the end of some live talk or something, saying that, oh, the people just didn't like Battlefield Earth because it was too much truth. Again, they're backing up that what I've talked about, that the highest level OTs of Scientology know is that, you know, when you get to the upper levels, that's what they teach you. It's basically the Zachariah Sitchin stuff, because that's supposedly where he got it from. So let's go through some of these other comments here. Travis says, I went to a Rosicrucian lodge in FW several times a few years back just to see what the BS was all about. Alongside the odd humming and candlelight rituals and symbolism, I noticed on their bookshelves were about four or five Zachariah Sitchin books. I'm wondering if there's any info on him and what clubs he was in. Yeah, I mean, I think it's pretty well known he was a Freemason, I think. There's a video of him. But look, bottom line, the reason the Rosicrucians would have his books in there is because, again, Rosicrucians, Freemason, Scientology. We're talking about stuff that intertwines and all is interconnected. Josh, another thing that bothered me about Freeman in relation to your work is how he could have interviewed you for the Council for National Policy, but instead he interviewed Suzanne Posell multiple times. That didn't make sense to me unless he purposely bypassed you in order to avoid certain topics that would implicate him and his connections. All the way up until Oracle Broadcasting lasted, Freeman was a defender of Alex Jones, even though he was aware of the CMP. Well, Susan Posell. I've been aware of her. I mean, there's been stuff she's taken from my work verbatim and never even uttered my name or linked me to any of my stuff. But she's tried to create a career where she's making me, you know, she's trying to basically put on the front that she is like the planted the flag at Plymouth Rock for the CMP research. But everybody knows the truth. I mean, I made the first film of the CMP. I'm the only person up till now who's been on 50,000 watt FM flamethrowers, mainstream big stations talking about the group, you know, other than before now. You know, the left didn't want anything to do with the CMP research until Trump came in office, and now they act like they've been all about it all along. It's hilarious. Another person says, I only listened to Freeman once. Something seemed off about him. Remember, no coincidences. Freeman is one of them. Josh, you're the only one who remains true. I've just found your work, and I'm amazed by the truth you spit. I was taken in by Leah Remini and thought she was so brave walking away from Scientology. She made out like she was just some ordinary member. Now I know the truth. I wonder why no one has ever interviewed her, has ever mentioned her links to the Nation of Islam. thank you for being the ultimate truth teller. Well, even it, like I said, in that, I think it was like a, that last episode of her show they did was like a roundtable thing. And they, one of the guys brought it up. And they cut to her and she's just sitting there like stone face, like doesn't say anything. And Mike Renders even says, well, I don't know how that would work. You know, you can't be a member of another religion and be in Scientology. He completely acts like free zoners don't exist. And they don't even mention, you know, this, the information that is out there. That's not a conspiracy theory, that she's the one that put up all the money for all the expensive auditing sessions that the Nation of Islam higher ups went through. Let's see here. What else do we have? All these emails from Michael, and he just as I got those other comments about Passio, he sent me this email, kind of synchronistic. Enjoyed your latest show where you mentioned Freeman. I've similarly got a slight "is he legit" vibe with his work. I asked you before your thoughts on symbolism and Mark Passio, who seems quite friendly with Freeman. Once again, I was curious if you come across much of his work on symbolism in the occult. Again, I came across, I don't remember exactly what it was. I came across something one time. I saw something he put out. Somebody sent me or something. I mean, it was clear out, and I can't remember exactly what topic it was on. It might have been on aliens, or it might have been on Freemasons. I don't know what it was. But there was something, and it was just, you know, for me, if I see somebody, I mean, if I see somebody put out something that's blatant disinfo, when, you know, clearly stuff like the truth of it is out there, and yet it's something they're reinforcing to something that's been corrected many, many times, I tend to tune out, not pay attention to somebody like that. So, I haven't really had anything to comment on his work other than that. But again, with him pimping out Battlefield Earth, just like Jim Mars, and saying, oh, it's, you know, people just didn't like the movie because it's got too much truth in it. Well, I mean, that really says it all, doesn't it? Where there's, again, you know, oftentimes where there's smoke, there's fire. I noticed Passio is friendly with Freeman constantly at his conferences, as Alex Jones listed on his link page of other truthers, and despite lots of shows and vids about breaking down Masonic symbolism, I've not heard him once mention Sirius. So despite enjoying his material, my spider sense is tingling. Who is legit these days? Well, yeah, that's the thing. Yeah, the Sirius stuff, I mean, I don't know why. So, I mean, you know, there's not really any benefit to ignoring that other than you're trying to, especially in terms of connections to Masonic stuff. I mean, it's one of the more blatant pieces of symbolism in the Masonic lore. Certainly ones that are a lot more obscure than that, that a lot of people don't realize or recognize, you know, when they see it. But, and I'm going to do an audiobook again. I read this book in the past on the show, but I'll read it again. Alice Bailey's Initiation, Human and Solar, where she talks about, you know, when you start going through the degrees of masonry, you're an adept, and then you get up to the highest degrees or whatever. 32 of which is obtained only, 32 Masonic degrees are only obtainable on Earth. The 33rd degree is a honorary degree. I had to explain this to someone over and over again on Facebook the other day, because a lot of people can't wrap their minds around this. And I think, now that I've known about this and lived with this information for this long, I really think that that's an intentional thing that Freemasons do to intentionally discredit people. Because the 33rd degree of Freemasonry, contrary to what most researchers and people out there believe, everybody gets this messed up and conflicted, and it's just flat not the truth. If you go into actual Masonic lodges, you go and actually talk to actual Masons, they will tell you this. The 33rd degree designation is an honorary designation given to non-practicing Masons exclusively. The highest degree in Scottish Rite Masonry is 32 degrees within the earthly realm. I think it's 17 degrees in York Rite. But the 32nd degree, if you become a 32nd degree Mason, that's the highest. If someone is a 33rd degree Mason, that person is not a Mason. They did not go through the 32 other degrees to get it's an honorary designation that they give to people who are non-Masons, who do works that they believe are in accord with Masonic teachings and practices. That is a fact. I believe they've given this designation to people intentionally to try and discredit that person in the future when that person's no longer around to defend themselves, as such as the case of Manly P. Hall, because lots of these Masonic lodges and lots of listings and stuff all list Manly P. Hall as a Freemason, but he was not an actual Freemason. That's what's so astounding about his work. He was given the 33rd degree designation and therefore is listed among Masons because they even they consider the people that are given the 33rd degree designation. Once they're given them that, they then are they consider them brothers and call them brothers and consider them as if they were members, but they aren't actual Masons that went through every degree to get there like real Masons are. And Manly P. Hall, he wrote The Secret Teaching of All... Have you ever read The Secret Teaching of All Ages? You've seen how thick that, especially the full unabridged version? And think about the fact that I mean, do you read that sometime? I'm not going to read it on the show. I've read some of it on the show because it's too fucking long, man. It's too fucking thick. Realize that he wrote The Secret Teaching of All Ages at 22, ladies and gentlemen, and never went back and changed any of it. Every Masonic lodge I've ever been in, toured and all that, they all have his work in their library, but he is not a Freemason, same as Pythagoras. The Freemasons refer to Pythagoras as our great friend and brother Pythagoras, but guess what, ladies and gentlemen? Pythagoras himself predates the advent of Freemasonry by a very, very, very long time. But since the Pythagorean schools came from the Egyptian and Babylonian mystery schools, so on and so forth, on in and later into the other groups, and that's eventually what became Freemasonry, because the practices are the same, they refer to Pythagoras as our great friend and brother and consider him one of them, a brother, a Freemason, even though, again, he predates the existence of Freemason by hundreds and hundreds of years. So, you know, the thing with Sirius, what they talk about, what the theosophist Alice Bailey talks about in Initiation, Human and Solar, is how when you reach the 32nd degree, that's the most you can reach in the earthly realm. There's actually 360 degrees in Freemasonry, but the other ones past 32 and 33 are not obtainable in the earthly realm. And it talks about when you die, you after you become the 32nd degree, and when you die, you then go to the next great lodge, the great lodge that's located in the Sirius system, or it says on Sirius or in the Sirius system, something to that effect. And that you basically start all over again. Like you could reach the highest degrees in the earthly realm. Well, when you go to the next realm on Sirius, you're an adept again and you basically start all over. And, people have referred to, you know, it's been stuff that people have referred to Sirius as an, you know, that it's being like this artificially intelligent, you know, basically, it's like either inhabited by or is completely run by like, you know, a massive computer system that went sentient and AI a long time ago and wiped everything else out and going on to, but the whole Sirius thing, I mean, the Blazing Star and, you know, Lucifer and the whole rest of it. Yeah, I mean, it is very much a part of the Masonic thing, but there also has been a lot of disinfo and stuff that's been put out there about Sirius as well. And you got to remember, a lot of these Masons and people like that put out their own disinfo. They've been caught doing that and doing that for many, many years because they want to keep... That's why they put out the stuff about them being Satanists and stuff like that, because they count on people not knowing the difference between, you know, Lucifer and the guy in the red PJs that sticks the fork up your ass for eternity, supposedly. It's all silliness. Anyway, so there you go. I mean, some of these guys you just have to draw your own conclusions on. I can't be the guy who confirms or verifies for you of every single person out there. Is, you know, look at their research, listen to what they say. You know, do you ever hear me get up here and tell you of a great researcher or a great, you know, whatever to go and check out? No, you never do. Huh. I wonder why that is. Now, in the, you know, if I do come across something I think you should check out, I'll tell you. But as long as you never hear me up here saying, hey, you should check out this person's show or check out that person's work. So long as you never hear me saying that, that means I got nothing. I got nothing to suggest. I got nothing. And again, you can draw your own conclusions on why that is without me having to say it. So, again, if I tell you somebody's good, take it to heart. But, you know, there is just not anybody anymore. No, nobody. There used to be one or two that I used to think, oh, that person, you know, is okay, and but everybody else is not. Nah, not anymore. They've all showed their cards to me at this point. So, I mean, it's terrible. It's the worst I've ever seen, and it sucks for me because I really like having, you know, other people I can collaborate with and work with and stuff. You know, there's not really anybody out there that I would say, oh, this person does great work or is a great researcher. Go check them out too. I wish there was. So that's why I just focus on making the documentaries that I make as chock full of information and stuff that you're not going to get anywhere else. And I think that's the best thing I can say about my films up to this point. You know, I think that, we have done that. All right. Well, this is our fundraising week for the show. We need to reach 100% of our operating cost goal by noon on Saturday, but it would be better if we could get everything by Friday in here. So we'll just set that as the goal by Friday. We'll have our we'll have a prize that we'll award to the highest contributor. We'll put pictures and stuff of that up later in the week, but we have another thing going on in conjunction with that. As we're also trying to raise the rest of what we need for the Spellcasters Volume 2. You can find pictures of this and the information up at our Facebook pages right now, the Global Reality Radio Network Facebook page and the Josh Reeves Talk Show Filmmaker Explorer page as well. The first person to donate $500 to either the Spellcasters 2 fundraiser or the Operating Cost Budget fundraiser by this Friday will get this insanely large Libyan Desert Glass Museum specimen. It values it over $1,200. You can even break up the contribution over multiples, so long as they are made between now and 5 p.m. on Friday. So if you want to do one to 200 now on one fundraiser and then the other, the rest by Friday, that's acceptable. So you can break them up across the different fundraisers, you know, if you want 100 here, 200 there, you know, until you stack it till you get to Friday or whatever. You can do that. This will probably be the last one of these I'll ever have. They're hard to come by, especially once it's big. This is your chance to help the cause. Grab a nice piece. It will only increase in value every day. You can use the links or the donate button at my website if you'd like to use a credit card or a debit card instead of PayPal. And bear in mind, this is a separate deal from our monthly prize to the highest contributor to our operating costs. And somebody may very well get both. Somebody will get. I mean, bottom line, I'll bottom line it for you. If you know, if one person does come in at $500 on this throughout the week, and nobody else goes over that amount, yeah, you most likely will win both prizes. So this could be pretty huge, and we'll announce what the other prize will be later in the week. So there you go. Get your contributions in now and help us stave off the red alert situation at the end of the week so we don't get down to crunch time and come up short. TheGlobalReality.com is where you can find all the information pertaining to my work and how to contribute to it. Check out the download shop there as well while you're out there and get yourself a copy of my latest volume one of The Spellcasters. This is, I, if there was any of these films that like, what was it? Going Clear, or my Scientology movie. I mean, they're shit shows. Total disinformation shit shows that don't tell you anything more about Scientology than you going in. And there's dots that are connected and things that you're going to see in the Spellcasters you're not going to see anywhere else, and that's really the bottom line. So go and go and get yourself a download now and be patient. Again, we're still waiting on the artwork to be done for the DVDs and Blu-rays. My hands are tied. There's nothing I can do because I'm waiting on the artist to be able to get his software going up and running again and everything. So whenever that happens, we'll get those out. But if you want to get it, you know, if you did buy one, you want to download while you're waiting, all you have to do is email me and I can send you a free download if you purchased a DVD or Blu-ray already. So take advantage of that. I'm going to try to get through a bunch of this news. I got shit tons of it. Men's Warehouse founder reveals how smoking marijuana for 50 years changed his life. Holy shit. You're going to love getting baked. I guarantee it. So fucking Cy Brolin was not only a Jew, but a weed smoker. I guarantee it. All right. You're going to love tripping balls. I guarantee it. Oh, man, I used to have this clip. I don't think I have it anymore. It was on a hard drive that died. It was fucking hilarious. I used to always play it on my show on 420, like, and I would play the song Smoke Two Joints by Sublime, like, right after it. It was a clip of Alex Jones. It was this old show. It was a clip. I had this clip picked out for years. I'd probably never find it again. It was it used to make me piss myself because it was like everything you want from a classic fucking clip. Because he's talking about marijuana and, you know, he's the motherfucking enchilada. He's always going off about eating enchiladas and shit. He called himself the big enchilada. That's what this fucking clip. He's like, folks, they say that smoking marijuana makes you want to kill yourself, but I smoked marijuana once when I was back in high school, folks, and it didn't make me want to go out and kill anybody. It just made me want to eat a whole half gallon of Bluebell Dutch chocolate ice cream and eat a whole platter of enchiladas. That's fucking funny. You know, any president that comes in, Barack Obama or Trump or all this talk about, Obamacare didn't get stopped and all the rest. I mean, again, these guys are not put in there to get anything changed or do anything different. They're there to keep the status quo there and keep the status quo in place. Listen, we haven't had a president yet that's done this, and because of that, to me, in my opinion, every one of them is null and void. Until we have a president that comes in the first day that he's elected and says, okay, first thing we're doing, full marijuana legalization and decriminalization across the board. Let's monetize this thing. I mean, you could give healthcare, free healthcare for all Americans. Trump could build his fucking wall. They could do all the $1 trillion infrastructure. What they would do, all they would have to do is full-scale legalization. But they won't do it because these guys don't get to the presidency unless they've got the backing of the big bankers, and the big bankers control the medical-industrial complex, which is exactly who does not want legalization, because there are so many drugs and cures and everything found in cannabis, and even like, hemp seeds and hemp oil and all that stuff that has no THC in it, and the CBD oil and all this stuff. You're talking about, if money's flowing one direction, in order to start flowing another direction, it's probably going to start stop flowing somewhere else. And the place it's going to stop flowing to immediately is the medical industrial complex. So it's not going to happen. But that's why I just, I can't stomach any of this bullshit. Oh, the same thing. Well, Obama can't change anything. Same thing when Obama first came in. Well, Bush fucked it all up so bad, he can't change anything. Now, same thing they're doing now. Well, Obama fucked it up so bad, Trump can't change. It's the same old fucking just repeat rants over and over again. And people are so goddamn stupid, they still fall for it every fucking time. Same shit, different day, until these cocksuckers come in. I mean, that's the thing. You could give every American health care, free health care for life. But who's going to be the big losers that? Well, the insurance companies. Insurance companies, the medical industrial complex, the bankers. Who the fuck do you... I mean, what comedian was it I heard? I heard a comedian. He was right on the fucking money, even though I... what comedian was it? even some of the stuff that he says, I'm not really, he's not really 100% right about, but who, you know, it rarely is anybody 100% right on. God, what comedian was it? I think it was Bill Burr, maybe. Yeah, I think that's who it was. Yeah, great point. You know, it's like, who in the fuck wants a job where it takes $100 million to get it, only to make, you know, $400,000 a year once you do? Is that not a red flag for anybody? I mean, yeah, that's, of course. Costs $100 million to get it, but you make $400,000 a year once you do get there. I mean, it's a racket, just like everything else. Some at NASA call for Earth's moon to be relabeled as a planet. Man, wasn't I just talking about that a couple of months ago? About how Earth was actually a moon for this other planet, Tiamat, that got destroyed, and our moon is basically just like the remnants of that. And all the craters are basically like the craters from these nuclear weapons that got annihilated. It's just a big rock floating there in space. Now they're saying, now NASA's starting to say it needs to be reclassified as a planet. Yesterday's, put this on a t-shirt. We need to put this on a t-shirt. Yesterday's conspiracy theory is today's accepted fact. It is, man. I'm telling you. I've talked about this before, but it's the fucking truth, man. Back in the 1990s, back in mid to late 90s, people, Bilderberg Group, which is now just accepted across the board, everybody knows about it. People who've not been into this stuff as long as I have don't remember this and aren't aware of this. Bilderberg, mentioning the Bilderberg Group back in like 1998 and talking about there being this one group that meets every year that, you know, steers much of what happens in the world, you were certifiable. I mean, it was as kooky as Little Green Men and fucking, you know, Mothman or any other crazy kooky shit, even though there probably is some stuff to those things. I'm just throwing out general, you know, general things that the public would say is kooky. I mean, just think of whatever crazy kooky thing you can name beyond that. Look, like aliens killed Kennedy from the mothership in Zeta Reticuli and put a hologram down that made it look like there was human shooters. Something, whatever. You were certifiably insane. I'll never forget. I think this was 2007, 2008 maybe. I'll never forget. This is back when I still drank. I was at a gas station getting a six-pack. And I was walking out the door. I almost had a heart attack. I was walking out the door of the gas station. I looked down. Dallas Morning News headline, front page headline, big bold letters. Right as I'm walking out of the store of the gas station, Governor Perry attends secretive Bilderberg Group meeting. And I mean, I just was, I was flabbergasted. It's 10 years before that, you were certifiable to even remotely believe there might be something, some kind of truth to that. And again, this is why that they have created and allowed so much of the conspiracy stuff to grow, because they knew it was going to happen and stuff was going to start coming out eventually. So they had to try and contain it. And this is really what happened around the time of 9/11 and the death of Bill Cooper and, you know, Alex Jones. Everything. This was really when they started to solidify the operation. And they weren't fucking counting on a motherfucker like me to come in and throw a wrench in the works. But that's exactly what, you know, that's exactly, in my opinion, that's exactly what keeps me alive and all this stuff. Because they do something to me, and all the shit I've talked about becomes gospel overnight. They are not going to run the fucking risk of fucking martyring my ass. I'll tell you that. So, I mean, it's, people are waking up to it. Oh, I had another email I wanted to mention before I get to this next article. I forgot about this. This came last night from a listener who says, are you watching CNN right now, right at this moment. Reza Aslan is on CNN promoting Free Zone independent auditors. Well, I was aware that he was. I saw the episode where he was eating the human brain or something. I knew they were going to do one on Scientology, but I didn't realize it was going to have this in it. They are promoting Free Zone independent auditors. I kid you not. He is interviewing independent auditors and talking about the non-affiliated branches and proudly saying that he defends Scientology as, quote, just another religion and not a cult, saying if there was media criticism of Jesus back in the first century, there would be no Christianity. He's taking the Scientology has corruption, so what's the big deal angle that every religion has corruption line. The independent auditors he is interviewing are saying Scientology has deviated from the original path that L. Ron Hubbard took, and they are merely following the more orthodox version, the more true teachings. It's just like you said. The mainstream media is doing a coup against Miscavige. You couldn't make this stuff up. You are 100% right. Well, thank you, sir. yeah, and it's exactly exactly what he says, as Reza Aslan says about it, is exactly what Jim Maher said. In that interview, and I quote, this is Jim Maher, Scientology is just like anything else. You can go to any other religion, we'll take the Catholics. They've had their share of bad press, right? Okay. And if you go to any other religion, Baptist or any others, you're going to find disgruntled members. You're going to find corruption. You're going to find some bad things going on. Anytime you get a whole group of people together, there's always 2% that's going to cause trouble. That's when you know you got one of these motherfuckers. There are a million verified examples of stuff you could name right there that Scientology has done. But instead, you take that time to say, well, there's bad people in everything. And in the same breath, say, well, I don't have anything to do with them. I'm not a member. Come on. But yet, you're supposedly a truth teller and a researcher. See, people, that's the thing, man. These guys, especially these guys that have been in this as long as Jones and Mars and these guys have, they're so into the con. They've been in the con for so long, they don't know anything else. And people are much more savvy now, and it's just causing them to be just arrogant about it. They don't even give a fuck that people know anymore. Because they fooled so many people for so long, but now that people have become more savvy to this stuff and have figured it out, they just keep on towing that line right along. I mean, it's unbelievable. Again, as I said, more people are waking up to it, but this has been this is why my work is so fucking important, folks. This is why you've got to support our work and donate to it. That's why we need an influx of cash, man. We need somebody out there that can donate just a few thousand, boom, off the top, so we got a war chest to work with here. These people, man, are trying to not only, they've already gotten what they've achieved with Trump and Jones, now they're trying to do this angle with Scientology and bring that about with a one world religion, while all the while convincing people that, oh no, it's actually good. We just got bad seeds in there. That's how they're going to do this. They are controlling their own opposition so that they can spin it back, so they can keep the ship afloat, ladies and gentlemen. This is what they're doing. And nobody else is fighting on this level, because everybody else is being brainwashed by the people they believe are truth tellers. People like Alex Jones and Leah Remini and the rest of it. There's nobody else, folks. If there was, I'd have them on my team. This is why we've got to have your support. Scientology conspiracy, U.S. religion gaining too much power in southern Germany, officials warn. Excuse me. German intelligence officials have been summoned to investigate the influence of the Church of Scientology over an iconic art museum in Munich, prompting concerns about the extent of the Church's power in a country already deeply distrustful of Scientology. The German government, which does not recognize the Church of Scientology as a religion, has long maintained a suspicious attitude towards the ideology of Scientology and has routinely monitored its activities in the country. The church, which German officials have accused of attempting to undermine freedom and democracy, is estimated to have about 1,200 members in the southern state of Bavaria alone. In Germany's most recent Scientology scandal, undermine freedom and democracy. Again, this is why you've got to see the Spellcasters and why you've got to help us be able to continue to make these films and do this work, because, ladies and gentlemen, what I show in that film is the history of psychological operations, MKUltra, and how it all seamlessly weaves together with the military psychological warfare that's been being conducted by people like Stubblebine, who fucking kicked the bucket recently, and Aquino, and the whole, you know, how it ties in with Jones and Scientology and all the rest of it. And this stuff is fact, man. And I know there's just so many of you out there that listen to my show that I know for a fact have not seen this film yet. And, you know, again, if you're waiting on a DVD or whatever, send me an email. I'll send you a download. But just go and buy a download. We've got regular quality for $10 and HD for $12. Just go and get this film. I'm telling you, even if you don't like or haven't liked some of my other work and you've never bought one of my films before, you owe it to yourself, if you don't ever buy anything of my shit again, to buy a copy of The Spellcasters, man. Get a download and watch. I'm serious. I know there are a lot of you out there don't like me, don't want to support my work in general, but I'm telling you, fuck what you think about me or whatever else. If you think you've heard everything, I've never let out all the stuff in the film, on the show, and whatever else. You got to see this film. Because there are many of you out there who may not like me or whatever else, but this stuff affects you too. And regardless of whether or not I like you and you like me, the fact of the matter is, this information is more important than that, and you need the information. That's it. Without a world government, technology will destroy us, says Stephen Hawking. You know, I've held back on this for a while. I think that I think we can safely say at this point that Stephen Hawking has had his fucking robot voice thing. I think it's been hijacked. I think fucking Russia hijacked that shit, or fucking WikiLeaks or somebody. whoever it is they say this week is doing all the hacking. Because a while back he was scaremongering up fucking the, hostile alien invasion threat. Now he's saying we need a world government, otherwise we're going to be destroyed by computers and AI robots. So world government, again, just as I've talked about with the staged alien invasion, he's fucking promoted, you know, hostile alien invasion and the rest of this stuff. That's always these guys' solution to everything, is any threat. And that goes back to the Kissinger-Rockefeller idea. And, of course, that fucking six-hearted fucking son of a bitch just finally kicked the bucket, too. Well, we had a lot of fucking good deaths lately. Now we just need Kissinger to fucking bite it. What else? Give me a second here to go through my stack. I got so much shit. Oh, fuck off. I hate when they do that. Put a fucking auto-playing video right in the middle of a news article. There's not much more annoying than that, is there? Oh, bear with me here. I've just got so much I've got to sift through. Scientist says there are over 100 planets in our solar system. So, wow. They're just throwing it all, wrenching all of it now, aren't they? Well, they went from saying there's, you know, Nibiru and Planet X. Now they're saying there may be over 100. But, of course, they don't provide any data or information on why they think that is. And we're just supposed to take them at their word. Okay. That is fucking hilarious. Well, there was one I had that I particularly wanted to talk about that had to do with the whole stage alien invasion scenario. Because one of the things that has been talked about for many years concerning the stage alien invasion and stuff like Project Bluebeam and the rest of this, you know, using holograms and holographic projections to create a fake rapture that people believe is real with the alien invasion thing, so that they can bring about one world religion stuff that way. One of the things it talked about was before they got ready to roll this technology out that there would be mass UFO sightings all over the planet, and that's going on right now. UFO sightings are at an all-time high around the globe right now as we speak, and they continue to prepare us and do all this prepping for, you know, for many years they spent all this time convincing us that aliens weren't real and you were a kook and a crazy if you believed in aliens. Now they've gone out of the way over the past 10 years to change that and try and convince people more and more that they are real. Because when they were trying to convince us they weren't real, that was when we were having real, actual arrivals and whatnot. Now the real, actual arrivals have slowed down because we've been a civilization long enough with the technology that we have for nobody in their right mind to want to fuck with us, not because they're scared of us, but because just, you know, we're fucking, you know, you've seen people like that. Just, you know, some guy at the bar or something, you could totally beat his ass, but he's just so out of his fucking mind, you're like, dude, fuck that guy. That's kind of how Earth is. And so since we've had an actual drop in these and we've been using back engineered extraterrestrial technology, and now we are reaching a time where this type of scenario would work in their benefit because of the technology levels that we've now achieved. Now they're changing the tide and now they're coming back and saying, oh no, well look, here's why they are. And then of course, as you know, that ties right in with my work in exposing Scientology and how they want this to become the one world religion, because they want to be the one religion that says that they've got it right. And this is why I can't tell you many people, folks, who literally have taken like the Zachariah Sitchin stuff as their religion. I see people saying, oh, thank Anu for that. I see people do that online and stuff. I've seen people leave comments, oh, thank Enki for this, or, you know, so say thank God or thank goodness or thank Jesus or whatever. Oh, thank Enki for that. I mean, there are people who are taking that shit on, and this is why the Great Deception is going to come right on people, and people are going to get swept up in the wave of it, and why Scientology is there, why people like Alex Jones and the rest of this are also doing this stuff where they're trying to provoke armed conflict and the rest of this. It all ties in. It's one seamless thing, ladies and gentlemen. One has to do with the other. None of these topics are separate. All right, that's all I got. I got to get back to work on this film, try to get this thing out. You got to support our work, folks. I'm telling you, it's no bullshit. I've been here for 10 years. I've been exposing stuff nobody else is. And look, we're not going to have a stand a chance. If I go under, there's nobody else on this level. That's just the way, especially at the level that we're making films at and going to continue to do. So you got to support our work. We'll see you next time, folks. Take care.